In this talk, I will talk about a parallel approximation algorithm for what are known as mixed packing and covering semi-definite programs. So I'll describe what this object is, and this is joint work with Panggui Yao. Okay, so let me say start by saying. As to why we are in general interested in fast parallel approximation algorithms for semi-definite programs. So in recent past, we have had some applications of such algorithms. For example, this result of QIP being equal to P-space, and also some recent generalizations of this result into what are known as classical and quantum double interactive proofs, which have also been shown to be in P-space. So, and previously also there were several works by Arora Kale, Warmeth Kuzmin, and Arora Hasan Kale, in which they also considered fast parallel approximation algorithms for several different some motivation coming from learning and from approximation algorithm for some NP-hard problems and so on. So, okay. So one thing I should mention is that in these algorithms, so they were polylog in the running size of the input program, but they also had polynomial dependence on some of the other width parameter. So this width parameter, for example, sometimes was, say, the norm of the matrices involved or the condition number of the matrices involved and so on. So therefore, in general, it is desirable to get fast parallel algorithms which are truly polylog in the size of the program and have no dependence on any width parameter. So when these algorithms had polynomial dependence on the width parameter, the workaround that was given in these applications was that for the specific semi-definite programs that arose out of the specific applications considered, the width parameter was separately shown to be small, like polylog. Okay. So, in this work, we are concerned with an algorithm which is going to be truly polylog, with no dependence of any kind on any width parameter. So there has been some history of such algorithms as well. Starting with Luby and Nisan, they presented a fast parallel algorithm for what are known as positive linear programs. And so these are basically linear programs in which the coefficients are non-negative. Okay, so and later Young had designed a fast parallel algorithm for a larger class of linear programs. So in Luby and Nisan's linear program, they had when they had linear constraints, the linear constraints was either of only of greater than equal to or less than equal to. Okay, so in mixed packing and covering, the constraints that Young had, so Young allowed both less than equal to and greater than equal to constraints. But of course, again with the restriction that the coefficients involved were non-negative. Okay. So, recently, what we did was we generalized Luby and Nisan's algorithm to design a fast parallel algorithm for what are known as positive semi-definite programs. So these are again semi-definite programs in which the constraint matrices involved are positive semi-definite, and also the matrix involved in the objective function is also positive semi-definite. So very recently, Peng and Tang Wong San in an independent work have presented fast parallel algorithm for positive semi-definite programs. Now their algorithm, you know, our algorithm was based on Luby Nisan's algorithm, but their algorithm is based on Young's algorithm. But nonetheless, their algorithm is also for positive semi-definite programs. Okay, so in this current work, what we do is we generalize Young's algorithm to what are known as mixed packing and covering semi-definite programs. So I'll describe what they are in a bit. However, we have a restriction that the covering constraints are linear. Okay. Okay. Also, what I will describe in a bit is that our work actually also implies a fast parallel algorithm for positive semi-definite programs, and also that this is actually conceptually a simpler algorithm than what we presented in this previous work, and also the dependence of the running time on the approximation factor is better. Okay, in this case, this is what I'm going to talk about. Okay. So this is the class of programs that we'll look into. So what we have is we have positive semi-definite matrices P1 through PM and P, and C1 through CM and C are non-negative diagonal matrices. Okay, so this is what I mean by saying that the covering constraints are linear. So the matrices C1 through CM and C commute, and therefore without loss generality we'll take them to be diagonal matrices. The restriction, of course, is that they're also non-negative, and all the matrices P1 through PM and P are positive semi-definite. Okay, and the program is so we are trying to maximize gamma subject to summation xi pi less than equal to p. So these are the packing constraints, okay, because we are trying to upper bound them, and then there are also the covering constraints. Summation xi ci is at least gamma times c. So there are the two competing requirements, that is, you know, if x is taken to be too large, then summation xi pi may exceed p. So by when we say less than equal to or greater than equal to for matrices, what we mean is the lunar order, right? So A is less than equal to B, it is basically a shorthand for saying that B minus A is positive semi-definite. Okay. So we have these two competing constraints, and we're trying to maximize gamma with this. So in this case, let us say that if we take the CIs to be scalars, okay, and C to be 1, then essentially it becomes summation xi ci, let's call them small ci's, equal to gamma, right? Because once they are scalars, we can as well just put summation xi ci equal to gamma. So therefore, what we're doing is we're maximizing summation xi ci subject to the constraint the summation xi pi is less than equal to p, okay? And of course, xi's are non-negative. And this is this class of programs is actually what I'm referring to as positive semidefinite programs. Okay, so therefore we can see that this class is a larger class to positive semidefinite programs. Okay. So now the way we will solve this optimization problem is actually by solving a feasibility question, and the feasibility question would be in general, in order to solve an optimizing problem, one can do a binary search to find out an optimal value for gamma, right? So one can start with some value of gamma and ask if this program is feasible for that value of gamma. If it's feasible, then you know one can go to a larger value. If it's not feasible, then one can go to a smaller value. So let us think, all right. And other thing is that, you know, once we have fixed a gamma, then we can absorb that gamma into, say, either C or CIs and so on. So we can think of gamma as one. So then from this program, essentially, we can go to this feasibility question. And in this feasibility question, also, there'll be another thing. So the question would be, either we find a vector x such that summation xi pi is less than equal to 1 plus epsilon times p. So this is, we're trying to solve slightly epsilon approximation version. And and summation xi ci is at least c, or show that this thing is infeasible, right? That is, summation xi pi is less than equal to p, and summation xi ci is at least c. Okay. Output infeasible. Yeah. Okay. So and also, I mean, one can see that even if we have an approximation version of this feasibility question, it's good enough to do a binary search to get the optimization question. So, all right, now once we have this feasibility question, again we can think of P and C as invertible matrices, because if there are any constraints which are sort of any directions which are zero, one can just forget about them, and therefore think of P and C as invertible matrices. And again, therefore, absorb P into PIs and absorb C into CIs to get finally this program, okay? Where we have P and C being identity matrices. Okay. So once we have this, okay. So here I will present the broad idea of the algorithm. So the broader idea of the algorithm would be to start with some values for the vector x, some small enough values, such that summation xi pi is less than epsilon times identity. Okay, so we are starting with summation xi pi being at most epsilon times identity. All right. We'll start with this value of x, and then we'll increment it, right? So when we increment it, our intention is to ensure that summation, the minimum eigenvalue of summation xi ci becomes at least 1. But at the same time, we don't want the maximum eigenvalue of summation xi pi to become too large, right? So we will want to increment in such a manner that the increase in the norm of summation xi pi is not much more than the increase in the minimum eigenvalue of summation xi ci. Okay? Once we are able to ensure this, it means that we are progressing fine. Now, the key point is that why should we be able to find such an increment vector at all, right? Where this kind of a requirement is met. So, what we argue is that if we cannot find an increment vector like this, then actually the instance is infeasible. So as long as the instance is feasible, it's always possible to find such an increment vector. Okay. Now, so this I will argue in a bit why we can say this. But let's assume that we can say this. Then what we will do is we will keep removing. So as we increment x, some of the covering constraints may be satisfied. So we'll keep removing those covering constraints and then stop once all the constraints are satisfied. Okay. All right. Now because handling maximum eigenvalues and minimum eigenvalues is not so easy, what we'll do is we'll work with the softer versions of the maximum eigenvalue and the minimum eigenvalue. And they're defined as I max of A is log of trace of exponential of A, which is, now if, so let us say that, our eigenvalues are like this. Okay? So, if we do exponential, then the largest eigenvalue will shoot up much more, right? So therefore, once we take the log of this, but once we sum all of them and then take log, we expect essentially the lambda 1 to come out, right? So this is this what is known as the soft version of lambda max, and similarly we can define I min as minus log of trace of exponential of minus A, and that will be the soft version of the minimum eigenvalue that we will use. And we can see that with these definitions, actually I max is larger than norm of A, and I min is less than the smallest eigenvalue of A. Okay, so this is for positive semidefinite A. Okay. So, once we have this definition of I max and I min, what can be shown is that if we increment the vector x with a vector alpha such that summation alpha j pj is at most epsilon, then the increase in I max is at most 1 plus epsilon times summation alpha j of this term here. So, this term, once we stare at this expression, this term seems to work like the partial derivative of I max with respect to xj, okay, the term in front of alpha j. Why? Because if the increase in the function value when we add the vector alpha j to xj should typically look like summation alpha j times the partial derivative of this function with respect to xj, right? And in fact, when we do explicit calculation for the partial derivative of I max of summation xi pi with respect to xj, it also does turn out to be that expression. Okay. And similarly, when the norm of summation alpha j cj is at most epsilon, the change in I min now turns out to be at least 1 minus epsilon over 2 times summation alpha j times this term here, which is also again the partial derivative of summation xi ci with respect to xj. Okay. So now what we are going to do is we are actually going to use these variables local jx and global x, and the way they are defined, we can see that the ratio of local jx and global x is actually the same as the ratio of the partial derivative of I max with respect to xj over partial derivative of I min of summation xi ci with respect to xj. So that so the reason why we consider, you know, these variables is because, as I said, what we want to ensure is that when we increase our x, we want to ensure that the increase in the norm of summation xj pj is at most is upper bounded by the increase in the minimum eigenvalue of summation xi ci. Now, that we can ensure by ensuring that the if we make an increment only for those xj's where the partial derivative of I max of summation xi pi is less than the partial derivative of I min of summation xi ci with respect to xj, then we can ensure the inequality that we want, right? Because of what we have seen previously. So what we want is that this ratio of local j over global x should be at most 1. So what we want to argue is that either we should be able to find the j's such that this ratio is at most 1, or we should be able to argue that if that is not the case at all, then this program is actually infeasible. Yes. In fact, for any given x, if we are not able to find a j so that local jx is less than global x, then the program is infeasible. Okay. Okay. So why is this true? So if we are given a vector y, suppose, so let us assume that the program is actually feasible with a vector y, then we can see that this expression here, okay, in this expression, the summation yj pj will be at most identity, right? Because y is feasible solution, and therefore, you know, this identity will come out, and therefore this numerator will become equal to the denominator, and therefore, this ratio will become at most 1. Okay, and similarly, if you look at the term on the right hand side, there's a summation yj cj which will be at least identity, so that ratio will become at least 1. Okay, so which means, so you know, once we take the summation yj pj out, it means that you know, this is less than that, so therefore there must exist a j such that this ratio is at most the corresponding ratio on the right hand side. Okay, so that's it. So this implies that there exists a j such that this ratio is less than this ratio, therefore, and once we take the, you know, this down and this up, it implies that the local jx is less than equal to global x. Okay. So now, given this, you know, this background information, we can now look at the algorithm. So we start with some values for xj's, which are small enough, as I said. And what we aim for is actually, you know, it's summation xi pi less than equal to identity. We scale identity by a factor n. So we are aiming for summation xi pi less than equal to n times identity. And also summation xi ci greater than equal to n times identity, or capital N. I mean, that is for certain technical reasons. We have to do that. So we want to ensure that the lambda min of summation xi ci exceeds n times identity. N, right? So therefore, as long as the lambda min of summation xi ci is at most n, we do the following. Set local j x and global x to be as defined. Then if the minimum j local j x is strictly greater than global x, as we have argued, we can return that the program is infeasible. Okay, so that's what we do. Otherwise, set g, you know, so initially, you know, g will not be set. So set g to be equal to global x. Yeah, because as we are arguing here, that take any x, right? If the minimum j local jx is less than, yeah? Because y is a different feasible thing, but we can, you know, put in y here and argue. So, okay. So we'll start. I mean, we'll set G to be equal to global X at the beginning, and then what will happen is that, you know, as we change X, we can see that this local JX will only increase, okay. And similarly, this global X will only increase because the numerator will only increase and the denominator will only decrease. So both these quantities, local JX and global X, will only increase. And so at some point, this minimum j local jx may exceed g times 1 plus epsilon, right? At which point, we will reset g to be equal to global x, okay? So this, I mean, you know, this parameter g is sort of important to keep it like this. And whenever g is a fixed value, you know, all those iterations, we will call them as being part of the same phase, okay? So let's take and as I said before that you know, whenever a certain constraint will be satisfied, a covering constraint, then we'll remove it, right? So that's what is happening in step D, and in step E, you know, so as long as, you know, we know that minimum j local jx is less than or equal to global x, so there are certain j's where local jx is we see that G is set to global X, and then global X only increases, right? So G is less than global X. So as long as you know, this says that, you know, as long as we can find coordinates j, so the local jx is less than g times 1 plus epsilon, which will be less than equal to global time global x times 1 plus epsilon. For those coordinates, you know, take alpha j to be some scalar multiple of xj. Okay? And that scalar delta would be decided such that the maximum norm of summation alpha j pj and summation alpha j cj is equal to epsilon. So this, you know, the fact that we have to keep this norm equal to epsilon will be important because we argued previously that as long as these norms are less than equal to epsilon, then we can, you know, say that statement about the change in I max and I min. Okay? And then once we are able to identify such a increment vector alpha, we just set x equal to x plus alpha. And then since, as I said, you know, in this we are sort of shooting for n times identity. So later on, in order to actually get for identity, we'll have to scale down x by n. So then we can return x star, which is x by n. Okay. So so this is what you know, I had previously stated, that these are the things about IMX and IMN. And now, so okay, so here we are trying to argue the correctness of the program, correctness of the algorithm when the program is feasible. So as I said, we are incrementing only in those locations, we are setting alpha j to be non-zero only in those locations where local gx is less than or equal to 1 plus epsilon times g, which is less than or equal to 1 plus epsilon times global x, right? Under that situation, we see that the term here, you know, will be less than or equal to 1 plus epsilon times the term there. Okay. So once we have that, then we can see that since we are only incrementing alpha j's are non-zero only in for j's where this inequality holds, we can, you know, since then, you know, one can sort of see quickly that the change in the IMAX will be upper bounded by something like 1 plus epsilon to the cube times the change in IMN. Now, if we define this potential vector phi x to be equal to, you know, I max of summation xi pi minus 1 plus epsilon cube I min summation xi ci, then we can see because for every increment satisfies this inequality, that this potential vector will only will never increase during our increments of the algorithm, right? Since this, you know, phi x starts at, I mean, because of our initial choice of x, it starts at being at most epsilon times n. Therefore, at the end, you know, at the end, I mean, x j c j will be like 1, okay? So therefore, I max summation x j p j will be less than equal to like 1 plus epsilon times 1. Okay. All right. So that basically tells us that the algorithm is going to be correct when the program is feasible. And about infeasibility, anyway, we have argued correctness before. Now about the running time, so we'll argue it in two steps. One, to first to say that the number of phases is small, and then to say that the number of iterations in each phase is small. And by phase, as I said, it is iterations in which g is the same. Okay. So now at the beginning of the algorithm, again because of the parameters that we choose, and also because, yeah, so due to the parameters that we choose, we see that the g starts at being 1 over exponential of n. Okay. And at the end of the algorithm, because you know, the constraints were satisfied, one can see that g is at most exponential of order n. And therefore, and now the thing is that, you know, in the algorithm, what we ensured was that whenever g changes because the minimum j local j x became larger than g times 1 plus epsilon, right? And then we reset g to be equal to global x, okay? Global x, which is greater than or equal to min j local j x, and therefore g increased by a factor at least 1 plus epsilon. So every time we incremented g, it increased by a factor at least 1 plus epsilon, and it, you know, went from 1 over exponential of n to exponential of order n. Therefore, the number of increments of g will be like order n over epsilon. Okay. Now, the thing is that this capital N from our choice, you know, let me just say again, capital N is like basically log n plus log m over 1 over epsilon, because from our choice of xj's, the norm of summation xi pi is 1. Okay, so it is essentially like log n, log of the size of the program, n. Okay, capital N is like log of the size of the program over epsilon. Now, if you look at into the number of iterations in each phase, again, because we ensured that the maximum norm of alpha j, summation I alpha I pi, now alpha I was delta xi, and summation I delta xi ci was equal to epsilon. And we know that throughout the norm of summation xi pi was at most n, and also summation xi ci was at most n. Okay, because whenever the any constraint was satisfied in the covering constraints, we removed it. So therefore, the norm of summation xi ci still remained for updated ci's like n, right? So therefore, this delta will look like epsilon over n, okay, and therefore it means that the whenever we increment an xi, it increases by a multiplicative factor of like 1 plus epsilon over n. Now, now if we look at the end of the last iteration in any phase, then let us say that some xj increases in that phase or in that iteration. Okay, then for that, local jx was less than equal to 1 plus epsilon times g. And since local jx is always increases during the algorithm, we know that since this xj was increased at the last iteration, it must have been increased because g was the same in in this for all the iterations in this a phase, local jx was less than equal to 1 plus epsilon g for all iterations in this phase. And therefore, this xj was incremented in every iteration of this phase by a factor like 1 plus epsilon over n. Okay. Now, so this is what it is. And again, from our choice of parameters, we can argue that xj, starts from being 1 over norm of pj and ends being order n over norm of pj. And therefore, because the increment is like this, the number of increments in each phase must be like order n log n over epsilon. And since n is like, again, log n plus log m over epsilon, the whole running time, so the total number of so the total number of increments in this phase look like 1 over epsilon square and then polylog nm, and the number of phases was also like n over epsilon, which is like 1 over epsilon squared times polylog in nm. So therefore, total running time turns out to be 1 over epsilon to the 4 and polylog in nm. Okay, so in conclusion, we have presented fast parallel algorithm for mixed packing and covering semidefinite programs with the caveat that we need the covering constraints to be linear. And in this algorithm, the running time is truly polylog with no dependence on any width parameter. Okay, so of course, the open question that remains in this line of work is, what is the largest class of semi-definite programs for which such fast parallel algorithms can be given?